Good evening. I'm Bill Moyers. I would have flunked every course I ever took in science had it not been for a teacher's pity or the generosity of a smart sweetheart. Over the years, experience, especially my experience in government, altered my appreciation, if not my understanding, of science and scientists. "Theirs it is to wonder," said Emerson, "and wonder is the seed of discovery." From the quark, so small nobody will ever see it, to the 53-mile-long supercollider, so expensive we may never build it, the world of physical science gropes with the deepest question of all. Why is there something instead of nothing? Sooner or later, the ambitions and illusions of politics come face to face with those driven men and women, those scientists, who accept no doctrine until the last doubt has been disposed of. Here at my alma mater, the University of Texas at Austin, Dr. Steven Weinberg is a member of both the physics and the astronomy departments. Weinberg is a high-energy particle physicist whose world is as wide as the heavens and as small as subatomic structure. But he calls himself a pre-computer scientist. He likes to work on blackboards or yellow pads, sketching theories about the basic forces that govern the universe, theories that won him the Nobel Prize in 1979. Dr. Weinberg, who heads the theory group in the physics department, writes not only for fellow scientists, but he reached out to a popular audience in the first 3 minutes, his seminal book about the Big Bang. We talked in his office on the campus.
Why do you study physics? I mean, what drives you? What do you get out of it?
It's a remarkable exercise of the mind. You know, I still can't get over it that you can sit at your desk and noodle around with equations and try out ideas and put together physical principles that may or may not be right. And every once in a while, you can say something about the real world. You can predict the result of an experiment, a new particle, or say something about the forces of nature or about the way the universe evolves. And all out of pure thought.
Most people don't think of pure thought as synonymous with the real world. We think of the real world as that desk, this chair, that body, mm-hmm. not some intangible idea up here in this mysterious organ. But it is the real world you're talking about.
Yeah, it is the real world. And one of the ways you know it's the real world is because you're often wrong. That's a great experience that natural scientists have that is very chastening and humbling, that all your great ideas can be overturned by experimental data.
But isn't it true that you're dealing with structures so small they can only be imagined?
They can be imagined, they can be described with mathematics. Right now, for example, there's a tremendous amount of excitement about a new idea in physics. It's not really new, but it's been revived in the last few years, called string theory. And string theory is very mathematical. But there's a more physical side in which you say the basic ingredients of the universe, the basic things the universe is made out of, are little strings, little glitches in space-time that go zipping around and vibrating. And when you say you have an elementary particle, what you really have is a string in a certain mode of vibration. You can get into terrible traps by using the physical description, but in fact we use it all the time. And when we talk to each other, we talk about these strings zipping around.
And so what comes to my mind is a string like I use in ordinary life. That seems
sure.
to me to the danger. That I'll confuse that with what you really mean in a pure way.
Yeah. Physicists aren't mathematicians. The mathematics expresses the concrete pictures. But sometimes we get very far away from those concrete pictures.
Let's take this layman's question for a moment. If it did begin with a Big Bang, so what? What difference does it make that everything that exists today was once part of a single force?
There's a tremendous amount of interest in these questions. It gives us a sense of finding out what kind of drama we're actors in. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how anyone could not want to know that.
What is it you want to know about the universe?
I just want to know one thing, which is why things are the way they are. I think that we've come a long way. You know, if you ask any ordinary question about everyday things. Why is the sky blue? Why is water wet? We actually know the answer. We, meaning the whole body of physicists and chemists and biologists, we know the answer to these things. Then you ask, why are those things the way they are? And we've come a long way. We now have a picture that underlies atomic physics in terms of the properties of elementary particles. It's sometimes called the standard model.
Mm-hmm.
which is a way of saying we all believe it and use it without being absolutely sure of anything. And then you ask, why is that true? Well, that's what I want to do. I want to trace these chains of why down to their roots.
Almost like a five-year-old child who goes around asking his or her parents, why?
Yes,
why,
that's right.
Why is the bird singing?
That's right. We want to be thoroughly unpleasant and keep asking, why is that true? When you get an answer, you say, well, why is that true? And the amazing thing is that we can go pretty far, but in doing it, we discover some remarkable things about the universe. One of the things we discover is that these chains of explanation seem to converge to a common source, because it doesn't matter whether you ask why is the sky blue or why is water wet, you always get down to this level of elementary particles and
what's it finally made of?
Yeah. It's true, when you talk about biology or astronomy, you have to bring in other elements, like the fact that the universe is billions of years old and it's had a long time to cook. But you always get down to that very simple level. And also we find that things get simpler as you get toward the roots of the chains of explanation.
What do you mean they get simpler?
You have to say less and less as you get deeper and deeper. There are fewer and fewer principles. We're beginning to get a feeling that we're really getting rather close to the roots.
Is it really possible to carry these whys so far back that you can say what's likely to have happened in the first hundred thousandths of a second? The first 3 minutes, the first 3 minutes, as you say in your book.
We understand the history of the universe pretty well from the first hundredth of a second on. When you go back earlier than that, you get into problems of physics that are difficult, and we have to be a little bit more modest. Now, that's really just tracing the history back. It doesn't really answer the question why the universe started at all. Why is there something instead of nothing? We don't know whether those kinds of questions are forever going to be separate. It may be that in the end, physics and history will come together, and we will not need special assumptions about the beginning.
You said a minute ago that it helps to understand the kind of drama we're in. And if your theories are right, that this universe is an expanding universe, then we are caught up in a drama that is evolving, that it is changing constantly, mm-hmm. regularly, normally, inevitably. It is changing. There has to be some significance to that, it seems to me, in terms of our everyday lives. It seems to make some difference to how I think about myself.
I think it does. I think that science has changed the way we think about ourselves, about our role in the universe. I think there's lots of historical evidence for the tremendous change in Western society that was caused by the scientific revolution of the 16th and 17th century. We stopped burning witches. I think the changes are incalculable. I wish they would go a little further.
What do you mean?
Well, it bothers me terribly, for example, that anyone still takes astrology seriously. Now, it's not because astrology is wrong. I mean, there are lots of wrong ideas, and I've had wrong ideas. There's wrong and wrong. There are wrong ideas that are simply wrong because there's evidence that they're wrong. There are other wrong ideas that are wrong because if they were right, you'd have to throw away everything you knew. How could it possibly matter to life on Earth that a particular ball of hydrogen and carbon and whatever, Jupiter, is in one position in the sky rather than another? If you believe that, I think you really have to rethink everything else. And you have no right, if you believe that, getting into elevators or taking aspirins or using any of the other advantages of technology, because you're spitting in the face of all of the science that produced the technology.
People don't want to believe what the scientists explain, do
they? Well, they believe it and they don't believe it. They believe it for some purposes and not for others.
They benefit from it. The technology that comes from the discoveries is a beneficiary, but it's also, in a sense, ultimately threatening, isn't it? If you even said, the more comprehensible the universe becomes, the more pointless it becomes.
In studying the universe scientifically, you don't find a point. Now, what kind of point would you have wanted to find? I would love to believe that human beings are part of a drama which is built around us, that we are the central actors.
We were there at the beginning. We were built into it in the beginning.
Yeah, that's right. That we are the central actors in the cosmic drama. That the whole expansion of the universe and the birth of the sun and the evolution of life on Earth was directed toward us, and we are the key players, and that when we do something, the whole universe is watching. It may be true, but you don't, if you believe it, you're not going to find evidence to support it in the discoveries of science. You don't find hints of that in scientific knowledge.
Science does not tell me that I have a special relationship as a human being to this universe.
Well, you know, so human beings are different from cactuses and roses, but...
I can think about the universe.
Yeah, that's right. You are different, but when you begin to ask questions about why you can think and why cactuses are the way they are and spiders are the way they are, you get down eventually to a level of molecular biology and then organic chemistry and ultimately down to elementary particle physics, and at that level you don't find human beings playing any especially important role. I don't mean that they don't. In fact, I'd say rather the opposite, that
this conversation suggests that they
do.
Well,
I think in fact they do, but it's one that they make up for themselves, that they create as they go along. And I think that's really one of the, in a way it's a more noble role. Here we are in this great expanding universe which doesn't pay much attention to us, and we're creating a little island of life in which there's beauty and scientific research and loving each other. And we do it all ourselves. We make it up as we go along. In a way, I find that more beautiful and more noble than if we were just playing a part that had been laid out for us in advance.
So many people need to believe that we have this particular relationship to the universe, that we were scripted from the beginning.
Well, you know, we are important. I find the people around me in my life are terribly important. It may be that there's no objective importance that registers in the cosmic equations, but importance is what we give to things. And I think that's not entirely unsatisfactory.
Is this an exciting time to be a scientist, a physicist?
It's not as exciting as it was 15 or so years ago. Every day, the theorists were predicting something new that the experimentalists might test, or the experimentalists were discovering something new that sent the theorists back to their desks. The kind of very fundamental elementary particle physics that I like to do has gotten a little too mathematical, a little too theoretical, and it's because we desperately need new experimental facilities.
You and other physicists are calling for the government to build something called the superconducting super collider at a cost of $3 to $4 to $5 billion. What is that?
It's a 53-mile long oval tunnel underneath the ground. In the tunnel's about 10 feet wide, there are two beams of particles, and they're being accelerated. That's why we call it an accelerator. They're getting faster and faster, more and more energy. And when they get up to an energy of 20 trillion volts, then at certain points in the tunnel, the beams are made to cross each other, the particles collide, and you get new forms of matter.
And that will show you essentially what?
It's going to increase the energy of the particles that we can study by a factor of 10. Now, every time you do that, you discover new worlds of physical phenomena. So I could just wave my hands and say, well, there's going to be something new that'll come along. In fact, in this case, you can say more than that. There are specific questions that we're sure are going to be answered by this facility. But the general experience is that the questions that you know are going to be answered never turn out to be the most important ones. The most important ones are things that you haven't thought of.
What do you say to the scientist who argues that there are cheaper ways than these big, giant projects to arrive at basic discoveries?
There is one kind of question that can't be answered in any other way. We've tried. You know, I'm perfectly willing to do it all myself. Just give me a couple of number one pencils and a yellow line pad, and I will go to work for you, and I don't cost much. But I can't do it. I've tried, and I and my colleagues are not able, by pure thought, to take the next step. It's not a question of improving the efficiency of our work. It's a question of allowing the work to be done at all. Do you want to know the underlying laws of physics, well, this is the way you have to go about it.
I think that the John Q. Citizen out there listening to you will say, I can understand that. Theories are cheap and experiments are expensive, and you have to take these theories off the blackboard and try to test them in whatever way the scientist decides is conclusive, either right or wrong. But what bothers John Q. Citizen is, how do you sort out all of the demands on scarce dollars? $26 billion for a space station, potentially, $4 to $6 billion for the super collider, $3 to $9 to $12 billion for Star Wars SDI, $3 to $6 billion for this research that the government wants to do in human genetic sequences. How do we sort all of that out?
The super collider is $4 billion, but it's spaced out over some years. It's a few hundred million dollars a year, and that's not comparable to the kind of spending that's going on in Star Wars or that would be going on with the space station. It's a harder question when you compare things like the super collider with, say, mapping the human genome, the great biological project. I think they're both very valuable. They both should be done. They're not expensive on the scale the space station is expensive or Star Wars is expensive.
Why don't the countries that want one, like the Soviet Union, Japan, and the United States, get together and make a truly international, non-political effort to build a superconductor, super collider that will serve all science?
If we don't build an accelerator like this on our own soil, then the next generation of graduate students in physics, when they get their PhDs, are all going to have to get into planes and go off to Geneva or the Soviet Union or Japan to do their work, because that's where the frontline instruments are going to be. Our country will lose a generation of elementary particle physicists. Well, you might say that you could face that with equanimity, but in fact, these elementary particle physicists provide a very important cadre of scientific talent.
What do you say then to my cousin who lives in the panhandle of Texas, who's about to retire after 35 years in one job and is worrying about whether or not he can, his $900 a month pension will be there, and whether or not taxes won't take too much of it, to say, why do we want to spend billions of dollars to find out what happened in the first hundredth of a second of the universe, or whether the universe is enlarging, expanding? Why?
You know, there are a lot of things in our society that are not needed to get through the next day, are not needed to feed and clothe and house us, but somehow make life worth living. I think finding out about the universe is one of them. I can't point to practical applications of the superconducting supercollider. There are spin-offs from the building of the thing. You know, we learn how to have superconducting magnets. We learn how to do online computing. It's going to be the largest vacuum chamber in the world. It's going to be the largest liquid helium facility in the world. So we get a lot of technological expertise out of building the thing. But I'd hate to rely on that. I think that doesn't do justice to the value, I would say spiritual value.
Spiritual value?
Well, you know, what else is it? We're finding out what kind of a world this is. We're finding out what the rules are. I think it's of great value to our society. It's one of the things we're proud of in this country. We're proud of doing this sort of thing.
You say it helps spiritually, and yet there are so many people who feel that science, I'm not one of them, but they feel that science does not give them a feeling for how to live their lives, that in fact it removes the ground of their faith.
But whatever faith you have, you ought to be willing to confront it with the discoveries of science. There's something ignoble about not being willing to look at what we found about the world, the way the world is, and trying to reconcile it with whatever you've decided to believe in for yourself. But how you do that and what you're going to wind up believing in is not for me to say. It's this world we're trying to explain. We create very artificial conditions in the laboratory, but it's not because we enjoy slamming particles together, and it's not because we're trying to win any world records for the heaviest and most exotic, weird new particle. It's because we're trying to answer that last why in the chain of whys.
And the last why is?
Well, we haven't got to the last one yet. I shouldn't have said the last one. I should have said the latest why.
Well, that's just it. It's a little bit like journalism, although we operate at such a more vulgar level. Our reports are always interim reports. Aren't scientific?
Well, yes, our reports are always interim reports, too. Maybe that won't always be true. Well, some people think it's in principle impossible. Other people think that it's in principle possible, but we'll run out of money long before we get there, and we'll never know the answer because we can't afford it. Other people think we're not smart enough, that the species is not smart enough, just like dogs are not smart enough to understand Newtonian mechanics. At least I don't think they are. We're not smart enough to make progress beyond a certain point. And they're all possibilities. But another possibility is the one that I've let serve as the organizing principle of my own life, and that is that we're really going to get there, that we're going to get to the end of the chain of whys, and we're going to see the few simple principles that govern everything.
And what do you take away from that?
Well, what you take away from it is that nature is a lot more simple and beautiful than you had thought. That if you look at a table of elementary particles, you see a lot of weird particles with a lot of different masses and a lot of different properties, and it all looks like a great big zoo, and you can't make any sense out of it. And then you find the underlying principles are extremely simple, and all these particles are just different solutions of some very simple equations.
And this suggests to you that everything is related?
Well, it suggests to me that when we relate things by getting down to this level of field equations, equations that govern the particles, we're getting to a very deep level because we're finding that nature is turning out to be extremely elegant and simple, and very, very few principles are involved. It's a faith that we have, that the final answer has to be a simple one. A friend of mine in physics, John Wheeler, has expressed it that when we finally learn the underlying laws of nature, they will be so simple and beautiful we will wonder why they weren't obvious from the beginning. And I don't know, I can't imagine that myself, but it does seem to be going that way.
All my life I've heard the term, as I suppose everyone has, that's a beautiful theory.
Yeah.
But I never really thought about what makes a theory beautiful. What does?
I think it's a slightly unfortunate phrase because it suggests that physicists are just aesthetes and choosing theories because they tickle our fancy and throwing away others. And you may wonder that we may be going off in some terrible direction of intellectual sterility. I don't think it's like that at all. The example I like to use is, it's not like saying that a poem is beautiful or
a sonata.
It's really like saying that a horse is beautiful. If you look at a racehorse and you say, that's a beautiful horse, you mean that you're getting a lot of cues which you can't even express in English. You can't bring up to your conscious mind that horse has qualities that win races. And when physical ideas are beautiful, you mean those are the kinds of physical ideas that win, that turn out to be right. Well, of course, you can ask, what are they? What kind of physical principles turn out to be right? What is the kind of beauty we look for? And in a sense, it is like the beauty of a sonata. It's the beauty of knowing that everything is the way it had to be, that you could not change a note without marring it. Not every work of art has that quality. If you look at a play of Shakespeare's, directors very often take liberties with Shakespearean plays. They don't put in new language, but they'll change language or move things around. Shakespearean plays are great, big, complicated things that to some extent mirror the complexity of life. It's a very, very great form of art. If you take something a little bit smaller in scale, more spare, more controlled, like a sonata, you have the feeling that nothing could be changed,
yeah,
that it is just perfect the way it is. It cannot be improved. That's what we look for in physical theories, the sense that they are the way they are because any change would sacrifice something that you couldn't bear to see sacrificed.
And you think they are the way they are because of the beginning, of the genesis, of what happened.
Oh, I don't know. That's asking too hard a question. Right now, we're working our way down painfully, and ask me that when we know the final answer, which I don't think will be soon.
Would you go to Shakespeare or Einstein to ask about the complexity of life?
Oh, for the complexity of life, there's no question, Shakespeare. And well, they're both such great men, but...
And you would go to Einstein for what? Simplicity?
Yes, yes. I think for a sense of why things are the way they are, not why people are the way they are, because that's at the end of such a long chain of inference, but why the physical universe is the way it is, you'd have to go to Einstein. But you know, it's both Einstein and Shakespeare together that do so much to create the meaning of life. Shakespeare, I remember after the assassination of Julius Caesar, he puts a speech into the mouths of one of the assassins, I forget which one, which I don't remember the precise words, but it's something to the effect that in future ages, how many times is this going to be reenacted? Shakespeare had a sense of life as drama, that the characters participating in a great event would see themselves as in a drama, and that life would take on extra meaning from that. Of course, he was having fun with the idea also, because in fact he was writing a drama in which they were reenacting this. But I think it's wonderful to think of ourselves as playing a part in a drama, and but we can't look to scientific discoveries for the script that we have to play.